Well, we do start chapter 6 of 1 Timothy today. Another situation where if I was calling the shots, I'd probably put the chapter division a couple verses later, because as we begin the chapter, we look at two verses that really are part of the collection of teaching for the local church and the community of believers that Paul has been emphasizing. And these are difficult verses because they deal with a very difficult subject, and that subject is slavery. Now, having said that, I know that many of you, in fact, maybe all of you at one point or another, have heard someone who has an agenda against Christianity, against the scriptures, seeks to mock our faith and our beliefs that the Bible is God's word. He's made that clear. And will do so often by saying, well, you know, the Bible endorses slavery, so how can you possibly believe that such a book is from God? And just throwing that out as if that ends the discussion. And it doesn't. It's a foolish statement. It's spoken out of ignorance. Though, yes, the Bible has some verses that deal with slavery. So we're going to talk about things besides slavery, but we want to spend a moment to understand what verses 1 and 2 are all about. So let's read them, and then we'll move on. Verse 1, let as many bondservants as are under the yoke count their own masters worthy of all honor, so that the name of God and his doctrine may not be blasphemed. And those who have believing masters, let them not despise them, because they're brethren. Rather serve them, because those who are benefited are believers and beloved. Teach and exhort these things. The reason it's such a challenging subject is because slavery has a very distinct part of our country's history. And we just naturally think of slavery in our country whenever the word is mentioned. Now, what was slavery in our country's past? Well, it's tied into the idea of taking someone because of the color of their skin, ripping them away from their homeland on another continent, piling them in ships like packed cargo, bringing them here and selling them as merchandise and treating them worse than you would treat a family dog, with no rights, no legal benefits whatsoever. That's slavery in America's history, isn't it? Now, that is nowhere near what slavery in the first century Roman Empire was all about. So right there, we have to understand the context in which these verses are written and what our history reminds us of. Again, I'm not about to tell you that first century Roman slavery was real easy and no big deal. It had a lot of serious issues as well, and the Bible seeks to address those issues. But there is an entirely different cultural aspect to it, and we need to understand if we want to know what we're talking about. And especially if someone wants to be critical of what God's Word says on the subject. The most important distinction to recognize, and this is pretty amazing if you think about it. You know, in our country, our nation, our Constitution almost didn't get ratified because of the issue of slavery. From the very beginning, there was a major debate between the states as to the issue of whether slavery should be allowed. Because at the very beginning, there were many young Americans, you know, the new country, saying slavery is evil. It has no place in a country that is supposed to be a beacon for freedom to the world. We are total hypocrites if we allow slavery to continue on. Meanwhile, in the southern states, because of the economic issues associated with it, and we're going to get to a verse about the love of money being the root of all sorts of evil, they were saying there's no way we're giving up slavery. We'll let this nation sink before we do that. And there was a huge debate, and ultimately there was a compromise. And you know what? You can't compromise with evil. There'll just be consequences down the road. And in our nation's history, those consequences showed themselves in a very bloody civil war, which so many people died, brother against brother, countrymen against countrymen. Now, I say that because this is the amazing thing. In the Roman Empire in the first century, you could not find a philosopher, a political leader, a religious person. You could not find one single individual in the first century who stated that slavery as an institution was wrong and evil. Not one person. It's like someone saying that, you know, cornflakes is evil. I mean, no one thought in terms of the immorality of it as an institution. Now, stop and think about that for a second. Now, that's not saying they're right, but that's the culture of the day. Here's the other thing. In the Roman Empire, the estimates were as many as 1/3 of the entire population were legally slaves. It was not based on skin color. There was no way of knowing if the person next to you was a slave, because slaves and free workers worked side by side in the jobs that were being done at the day. It wasn't like that's slave labor. It's so different from our country's horrible history to recognize, to step into the Bible. In fact, there was specifically no special clothing or something that slaves would wear, because there were so many that people were afraid that, you know what, we could be working a job site and guys could look around and say, hey, there's 50 of us and only 5 of them. You know, what are we doing this for? And so it was a different world. Now, here's the other thing. Maybe this is why they didn't see it as evil, because basically slavery was based on the idea of survival of people who otherwise should be dead. Would you rather be dead or a slave? That was the mentality of the day. Far different from ripping people from the peace and life that they know in their homeland and taking them to another continent by boat, isn't it? Typically, prisoners of war were one aspect. Well, instead of killing you, we're going to make you our slaves. Here's another aspect. You know, they had all sorts of sexual sin in those days as well, which led to unwanted pregnancies. But rather than having millions of abortions, what they would do when the baby was born, they just leave in a field somewhere to die. Very common. And so if you found such a baby in the field that was still alive, the law gave you the right, if you wanted to invest the time and the money and the effort to bring that child into your home and keep it alive, then you could make that child your slave. You could do that. Again, the idea is, otherwise the child just dies in the field. And so this was a mindset. Now, I say all that because we think we know better than God. If I was God, this is what I would do and this is what I would say. But we're not God, praise the Lord, because we would mess it up. What God did in the power of the gospel to change the human heart, because as you change a human heart and you change a second and a third, and pretty soon you change enough people, you change an entire country. And you change an entire country, you change the laws of that country, don't you? Let me ask you something. When you look around our world today, and there is still slavery practiced in many parts of the world today, but let me ask you, is there any nation in this world where the Christian gospel, or the gospel of Jesus Christ, has had strong influence and dispersion abroad where you find slavery today? And the answer is no. The nations that still have slavery today, where it's taking place, are not Christian nations whatsoever. And just like there are those who blame Christianity for slavery, even in our country, as horrible as it was, and we don't dismiss the idea that, yes, some of those slave owners pointed to the Bible and professed faith in Christ, but you can't blame Christianity for the existence of slavery without also giving credit to the Christians and Christianity for its overthrow. It wasn't like the atheists were the only ones against slavery back in the day. What God did in giving this instruction, let's look at it again. He's telling the slaves, no, don't revolt, because you know what? That's going to stop the Christian influence in its tracks. Because no one in society is ready for the idea of a world without slavery. It wasn't even a thought in the Roman Empire. So we're not going to go down that road. Instead, what you're going to do is you're going to be witnesses for Jesus Christ. You're going to be the hardest workers. You're going to show respect, honor. You're going to love. Because in Christ, and this isn't the only place it's taught, as you know, you're free. And that's what really matters, who you are in God's sight. And if you're free in this world, you're a slave to Jesus anyway. And in Christ, there is neither male or female, Jew or Gentile, and slave or free. There's an equality, there's a oneness. And so, that the name of God and His doctrine not be blasphemed, you go ahead and you work hard and you show respect. And if you get a chance for freedom, which is another big difference between Rome and our land, it was not uncommon at all for slaves to be given their freedom. By all means, accept your freedom, God's word says. And there's plenty of instruction for how the masters were to treat their slaves as well, not to take advantage of them and so forth. And so that's the idea here. And we just don't have time to develop it in even greater detail, though we could. But just understand that we look at the Bible through the lens of which it was written and seek to understand it first and foremost from there. Then we bring application to us today. There's nothing in the Bible that would support what we in the United States as a history, I say we, I know none of us personally, but the country did when it comes to the evil institution of slavery. Nothing at all. Scripture supporting that. But it's interesting, as we move ahead, we get now, and this is why I said I like these verses at the end of chapter 5, because now we come into the home stretch. We're wrapping up. What's the point of this letter? Paul writing to Timothy, Timothy, you go deal with these false teachers out there that are teaching things that they should not teach. And now we get to the sort of stuff that they were teaching. And so I think verse 3, as it starts off, if anyone teaches otherwise, I don't think it's just a reference to the first two verses we looked at, but all that's gone ahead in these five chapters before. So what does he say? If anyone teaches otherwise and does not consent to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which accords with godliness, that word godliness has been an influence throughout this letter. He's proud, knowing nothing, but is obsessed with disputes and arguments over words, from which come envy, strife, reviling, evil suspicions, useless wranglings of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth, who suppose that godliness is gain. From such withdraw yourself. These are the teachers that were causing problems in the first century, and isn't it amazing to see the similarity to our day as well? You know, it's ugly enough when someone who's really smart is also filled with pride. You know, one of those guys, he says, I know I'm the smartest guy here. I know how to do it better than any of you. And just looks down on everybody filled with pride. That's pretty ugly, right? But I tell you, it's something to have someone who's filled with pride and is also stupid. And that's what we're dealing with. He's proud, knowing nothing. What do you got to be proud of? You don't know what you're talking about. Now, does that sound like some of the people that you've talked to about the Bible in your past? The sort of person who says, the Bible endorses slavery, as if they've just ended a discussion? You don't know a thing about what you're talking about, and yet you're all proud that you have the perfect understanding. Proud, knowing nothing, and look at this, obsessed with disputes and arguments over words. I bet you didn't know that the internet was in the Bible. Doesn't that sound like a lot of internet activity today? Let's argue and debate with people who don't know anything about anything that we believe. What does it lead to? Oh, envy, strife, reviling, evil suspicions. Anyone ever called you evil simply because of your faith in Jesus Christ? It's happened to me. And so we're reminded a little bit of when Jesus gives us that instruction about the pearls before swine, which I know is like one of those weird verses, like what does he mean? And it's hard to really grapple it down, but I think we all can understand that the idea is, you know, be careful who you're talking to and debating. And I've said many times there's two types of questions. There's honest questions. People honestly have a question. Someone comes up and says, why should I believe the Bible is the Word of God? And it's an honest question. I'll talk to them for hours. But a lot of times, there's dishonest questions that just want to start an argument, right? How can you believe the Bible's the Word of God? Jesus experienced that too. Remember the Pharisees would show up to him, why do your disciples not wash their hands? And you know, they're not looking for an answer from the Lord. They're just trying to accuse him of something. They want to get into a fight and a big argument with him. And you know, the thing about the Bible, it's described as a sword, right? Illustrated, you know, the sword of the Spirit, Word of God. When you think about a sword, and by the way, a sword can be both an offensive and a defensive weapon, right? And scriptures use that way. Jesus uses the scripture defensively when Satan's tempting him. Remember, he quotes scripture right back at him, doesn't he? Of course, you can use the scripture offensively, and Jesus did that as well. We see that in different ways in his teachings and his confrontations. So can we. But you know the thing about a sword, have you ever seen a soldier when he's in the battle then saying, now let me talk to you about my sword. This is the best sword. I can tell you I have so much confidence in this sword, and go on and on about the sword. You use the sword. Amen? You see where I'm going with that? It's one thing to have a legitimate discussion about why we should believe the authority of the Bible and discuss those things in an apologetic sort of thing. That's legit. But you're going to run into a lot of people in this world that are just like the Bible's describing here. They're proud. They don't know anything. And all they want to do is fight and argue with you. And you know, it's pearls before swine. And you can sit here and describe your sword all you want. Just use it. Just say, you know, Jesus says he's the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except by him, and I believe that. How about you? He says he's the resurrection and the life, and if we believe in him, we'll never die. That's what I believe. And we use the scripture. Plant seeds. One man plants, one man waters. God gives the increase. But we can spend a lot of time in the useless wranglings of men of corrupt minds who are destitute of the truth. And you remember what we saw last week when Timothy was encouraged. Hey, don't partake with other people's sins. Because isn't it true that a lot of times you start wallowing in the mud a little bit, and then you get all angry, you get in the flesh, you start cursing out his mom, and, you know, and that's not a very good witness for Jesus Christ, is it? But what about this ending line, which the next few verses then flows from? Those who suppose that godliness is gain. Now that's not only found in the Christian church, those false teachers who think, well, you're really godly if you got a big bank account. But it's the world standard as well. That's the only God that matters to many people. The almighty dollar, right? Mammon. And that's why Jesus picked that particular contrast. You can't serve God and mammon. He could have picked all sorts of other examples. He picked that one. Because that's what the world runs by. He says, withdraw yourself from those people. In contrast, verse 6, godliness with contentment, that's great gain. Seek godliness, godly living, godly beliefs, godly lifestyle, and be content. That is a great gain. Hard to argue with the logic of verse 7, for we brought nothing into this world, and certainly can carry nothing out. Who can argue with that one? And so, having food and clothing, with these we shall be content. Clothing is kind of a broader word there, not so specific as clothing. It's the broader word for covering. And so some see the idea of shelter also being included in this as well. And when you think about it, you got food, clothing, and shelter. Your needs are met. You can be content. God promises to meet our needs. We can't take anything with us that we get more than that. But then we get to verse 9. And this is the issue. Those who desire to be rich. Oh, that's the key. Desire to be rich. Is it a sin for a Christian to be rich? No. And we dealt a lot of this when we were going through the book of Proverbs, didn't we? There are many rich Christians for whatever reason. Maybe they're successful business people. Maybe they worked hard and studied hard, made wise decisions, wise investments, whatever the reasons might be. Maybe they just inherited a lot of money from some atheist relative. Who knows? But it's not a sin to be rich. We then are stewards of everything that we might have. Oh, but those who desire to be rich, that's a different thing, isn't it? See, that's what's motivating. the person. I desire to be rich. Why are you starting this company? I like to provide a good product, a good service to the public. I like to make their life enjoyable or to make it blessing or make it easier, whatever it is I'm selling. And I also like, as this business grows, I get to hire people. I get to give employment to workers, and those workers are able to feed their families and have children with the paycheck that I provide for them. And then as we continue to grow, we're able to give back to the community. We do charitable work and all that. And that's a Christian businessman. And there's a lot of them out there. Not like, I just want to be rich. How can I cut corners? How can I lower the quality here to make a little bit more to the bottom line? How can I rip off my employees? How can I make sure that if he's 1 hour away from getting, you know, a higher level of pay, I make sure he never gets that hour under my watch? And all the kind of junk that goes out there in the world today, all because of the bottom line, the desire to be rich. Two totally different things, aren't they? Because when you desire to be rich, what happens? You fall into temptation and a snare and into many foolish and harmful lusts which drown men in destruction and perdition. Look, the guy says we can't have the contract unless we can promise to finish the job in a month. And we can't do it, boss. It's going to take us at least 6 weeks. Promise him a month. We got to get the job. What's he going to do after a month? Is he going to kick us off the site by then? We'll make up some excuse, but we need this bid. Does that sound like our world today? You see? But it's a temptation. If we don't get this account, we're not going to be able to pay the bills this month. And on and on. Temptation. How about just trusting God? That your existence doesn't depend on this account or this person buying or whatever, and just be honest and faithful. So, see, if you desire to be rich, that's different from this God blessing hard work and wise decisions and good choices, godly choices. And then verse 10, often misquoted. Notice, please, the love of money, not money in and of itself. Money's a means of exchange. We could be trading seashells or something, right? Say we use pieces of paper that are printed with presidents' faces on them. We don't even do that anymore. Right now, it's just numbers on a digital screen somewhere, and they transfer, and it's like, wow, I got a lot of money. Let me type up a big number. Here you go. Money's not the issue. Love of money. Money's what we're sending to Christians in other parts of the world so they can have food and shelter and Bibles and education, and the gospel can be spread and we can build a church. And it takes money to do those things in your own life. It takes money to feed your family and clothe them and all that. Money is not the issue. The love of money, the root of all kinds of evil. And isn't it true? You start thinking about evil things in our world. Is there some money component behind them? Is pornography evil? Yeah. Anyone getting rich off that? Oh, yeah. How about something like horrible, you know, child trafficking or whatever? Anyone at the end getting rich on that? You bet. How about the drug trade? Anyone getting rich on that? You bet. See? Money is so closely associated as a root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Desiring to be rich, the love of money. And you know, I think that's one of Satan's biggest lies, one of his biggest temptations. And it can be a temptation to the Christians as well, because just in society as a whole, and of course our whole advertising community and everything plays to this, there is this message that you'll find happiness, you'll find contentment if you just buy this thing. And often that thing is a little more expensive than you can afford, so you work and you save and you struggle and you do to get to that thing, and you get that thing, and then you find out that didn't bring me contentment. But then there's another thing a little bit higher up, isn't there? There's always something. There's always a slightly nicer car, a slightly bigger home. And if you got a bigger home as you want, then get a second one. You know, get one on Maui. And you get one on Maui, then get one in the Swiss Alps or wherever you go skiing. And that's what the millionaires do, right? In other words, even for the people who are the richest in society, there's still that thing. I need my own jet. I need my own yacht. And on and on and on it can go. But just the average person down here is just like, yeah, I just want to have a little more. You know, and we can chase that until the day we are put into the grave. And that's exactly what Satan would want us to do. And it's a big lie. And it often leads to temptations, and it just gets our focus off what God would have us to do. When Jesus himself makes it so clear that lay up treasures in heaven, not on earth, that should be the focus. And so, it's as if Paul wrote this letter having just watched 5 hours of Christian television. It's amazing how something written in the first century, all this stuff has so much relevance today. And again, it's bad enough when it's in the church, but it is absolutely flooding our society in this country. And we have the opportunity to be the witnesses unto the Lord that he would call us to be. And so, to have contentment in godliness, that's not only great gain, as the scripture says, but you know what else it is? It's a great witness to those around you who, despite whatever they have, still don't know peace with God if they're outside of Jesus Christ. And I don't know, again, I know most of you, of course, are believers. I hope all of you are. But our issue in this life is our relationship with the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Knowing him, his death for our sins, his glorious resurrection on the third day, for our resurrection to come one day. We need to listen to him. We need to govern our lives because he's given us everything through the teachings and the Word of God. When rightly divided, properly understood, everything that we need in this life to live a godly life. And a godly life will be a life filled with love and peace and contentment in a world which is absolutely falling apart all around us. May it be so.